Books. It's Laurelann here. Today I'm doing a wrap up for November and December. I didn't do a November wrap up because I only read like 1.78 books. The reason I didn't finish the other one is because it was a library book back in Scotland and I didn't finish it before I had to return it and move back here to America. So I guess I'll never know what happened at the end of that. I also kind of took the holidays off, but I'm back feeling refreshed, and I'm just gonna try to get this out of the way as quickly as possible so that then we can get to the fun end of the year stuff. The first book I read back in December was The Dragon Republic by R.F. Kuang. This is the sequel to The Poppy War, which I read earlier this year and really enjoyed. This fantasy series is set in a sort of ancient China-inspired world, and it's about a young woman named Rin who comes from a very poor background and is able to make her way into the very exclusive military academy in her country where she will be trained to be a general. And so this being the second in a series just follows on from the events of that book. It is very intense. The characters, Rin in particular, are kind of dealing with some PTSD symptoms, so there's some pretty dark character stuff going on. I really loved this. I think it was better than the first one. It was very high action, high stakes. But the real strength of this series is the characters. They're just really good and I love them and they're my babies, and I'm really freaked out by the thing that happened at the end of this book. And I'm looking forward to the last one. Apparently it's coming out this year because I guess R.F. Kuang can write 60 million words per minute. I don't know. Cool. So the next book I read was Little Women. This was one of my favorite books when I was younger. I think I read it 2 or 3 times back then. I, like many of us, was obsessed with Jo March. I wanted to be her. So, you know, I just had very fond memories of this book and I wanted to reread it because of the new movie coming out. It also has like very Christmassy vibes to me, and so it felt like a really good thing to read going into the holidays. Here's the thing though, I don't think this was as good as I remembered. Of course, I can recognize it for the thing that it is. It's a classic. It was groundbreaking for its time. Louisa May Alcott, I've got no beef with you, if you're watching. But the thing about this book is that the first half is when they are children, and that is nice. That's like the happy, fun stuff that most people remember. But then the entire second half is them as adults, and I just like couldn't get behind it. Like, it gets a bit boring, and all of the things they deal with, I was just kind of like, ugh. And I'm not really sure why I had such a hard time with this, because usually when I read classics, I'm very much able to take a step back and rationalize it. This is a product of its time. It wasn't written now. But what Little Women is less of just like a novel meant to entertain and more of a series of parables slash sermons if you're feeling a little bit less charitable, maybe. So I feel like from every episode in the book, you're meant to learn a lesson from it. But the lessons are just not lessons that modern audiences are gonna jive with. Like, to use an example, this I guess is a spoiler if you care. I'll put something here and when it goes away, the spoiler's done. The one that bugged me the most was that when Jo moves to New York, she is supporting herself with her writing. And that's really cool. Woman in the late 19th century is supporting herself with her craft. Awesome. And then her crush, Professor Bear, reads one of her stories, not knowing that it's hers. He just sees it in the newspaper and he's like, "This kind of story is trash. And the people who write it are bad and immoral because they're encouraging immoral behavior." And Jo is like, "Oh my god, he's right." So then she just quits writing. Like, she quits writing in the book. The book ends with her no longer being a writer and going off to start a school for boys. It makes no sense. So basically, I still enjoyed the process of like re-experiencing this book because I had such fond memories of it, but if it doesn't have like a nostalgic value for you, probably give it a miss. Both the new movie and the Winona Ryder movies are better than this book, or at least like more enjoyable. Yeah, like sorry, I guess. I don't know. I feel really bad like kind of trashing Little Women because like I said, it was an old favorite, but I feel what I feel, man. The next book I read was The Lying Room by Nicci French. Nicci French are a husband and wife thriller writing duo, and I think that's really adorable that they do that together. So this is about a woman named Neve who is very well liked in her community. She is married with kids. Her marriage has kind of hit a fallow period, I guess you could say. It's stagnated. And so she has begun having an affair with her boss. Classic. The book opens with her going to have a little tete-a-tete with her lover, and she finds him murdered in his apartment. And she does the very normal thriller character thing, which is that she decides that instead of calling the police, she's just gonna clean up the crime scene because she doesn't want her family to find out that she's been having an affair. So right off the bat, that's a premise that doesn't really gel with me just because I think those actions are entirely incomprehensible. But I actually ended up really liking this book. There is a cop character who I actually found very interesting. You can tell he's kind of suspicious of Neve, but he also likes her. And there's like a very weird dynamic there. But in my opinion, the very best thing about this book is the relationship between Neve and her daughter, Mabel. At the start, they have a very fraught relationship. Mabel is going off to college, but she is just really moody. She has behavior problems. I think it's sort of implied that in the past she may have had some drug issues, but from the very beginning she kind of has a suspicion that something has happened between her mother and this person, her boss, who has been murdered. And throughout this adventure of trying to cover up their affair and solve this mystery of who actually killed the boyfriend, they become really close. And I don't know, I just thought that was an interesting dynamic, a good way to put like a mother-daughter thing into a thriller. I'm really killing it today on the describing of the books. The next book I read was History of Wolves by Emily Fridlund. This is about a 15-year-old girl named Linda who starts babysitting a 4-year-old boy named Paul when his family relocates from the city to the rural Minnesota community that she lives in. We learn pretty much from the beginning that something bad has happened to Paul, and the book just sort of slowly meanders your way to the answer of what has occurred. There's also like a subplot about this teacher at her school who's like maybe a pedophile, but that's a bit harder to explain. I read this as a buddy read with Christy over at Books Are Neat, and we both really liked this. I thought that the writing was absolutely stunning. Emily Fridlund does so many really beautiful and interesting things with her sentences and her language, and paints a really rich picture of this wintry, rural Minnesota setting. I also just felt so much love for the characters. They're so human and so flawed, and it's been a little while since a book made me think so much. And I think part of that was probably because of the buddy read and, you know, typing out my thoughts as I went. And the twisting of the narrative was really compelling as well. So yeah, overall, I just think this is a really special book, and I would recommend it to you if you like this kind of thing, basically. I think it is probably pretty polarizing. The next book I read was A Stranger in the House by Sheri Lapena. This is about a woman named, is her name Karen? I can't remember if that's her real name or if that's just like the typical middle class white lady name. I need to check. Oh yeah! Yeah, her name is indeed Karen. This book begins when this woman named Karen is in a very strange car accident. She just sort of runs a red light and like runs into a pole or something. And right from the beginning, the police are very suspicious of Karen because she was on the wrong side of town. And let me tell you, the words housewife and the wrong side of town were repeated so many times throughout this book that should have been the title. It was just so annoying to me. And also, like, Karen has a job. Like, she's a bookkeeper, and yet everyone in the whole world of the book referred to her as a housewife. Exclusively. A housewife. Why? Also, the husband, Tom, I would say his perspective is kind of the main one going through. He just sucks. And I don't mind an unlikable character, but I think that we're actually supposed to like him and like be on his side and think, oh yeah, the things that he's thinking are totally understandable, but actually it's pretty fucked up. Like, he keeps talking about how his wife is so perfect and his marriage is so perfect, but once this one thing goes wrong, he's suddenly like, oh my god, who is she? Are we gonna break up? I think maybe I need to break up with her. And I was just like, ugh. And then we also have her best friend who lives across the street. I don't remember her name, but she is like weirdly obsessed with this couple. Can you tell I didn't love this book? Now, I do say all this with the caveat that I listened to this on audiobook on a road trip with my friend, and I think that flurry of circumstances sort of came together to make this as annoying as it possibly could be. Like, I just noticed things that annoyed me more than I probably would have if I'd just like sat down and read a paper copy of this on my own. And then also, this book ends with two like shocking twists, and I don't really like when that happens, when it's like you have this whole story and then it's like, okay, now in this chapter we're gonna say something that's just gonna change everything about this character that you thought you knew, and that's a twist somehow. Yeah, I don't know, I think I just have to maybe take a break from thrillers at this point because they're just not as well written as I want them to be. Maybe they're just not for me. And now for the last book I read in 2019, it was Three Women by Louisa Taddeo. This has been one of the hugest books of the year. I'm sure you've heard of it. And I can say that from my perspective, it's worth the hype. This is a nonfiction book about three women from different parts of the United States, different financial backgrounds, and it mostly focuses on their sex lives and kind of the ways in which they have each been harmed by men. The writing in this is so rich and so lyrical. It really is a nonfiction novel. I think some people have kind of sold this as a book about women's sexuality. It's not that. It's just a story about these three women. But that was something I really enjoyed. I just really felt connected to these women, and knowing that they are real women just felt very exciting and fresh. Louisa Taddeo actually spent like 10 years getting to know these women and living with them and writing this book, and I just think it is a real feat. One thing that I do have to say is that they are all white women. I listened to Louisa Taddeo interviewed on a podcast, and she said there were several women of color who she actually started to connect with and started to write about, but who kind of backed away because they were afraid of how the book would impact their relationships. So, you know, she tried. Did she try hard enough? I don't know. I don't know her. Yeah, that's just a little warning I wanted to put out there. This book is just very interesting and I think really captures what I love about reading. Like, I'm reading about other people's lives, but these are real people. It's very sad and difficult to read at times, but also very sexy at times. I don't know. I just dig it. So yes, this has been my very eloquent November-December wrap-up. Thanks for sticking with me. I will see you again soon for my worst and best books of 2019. See you later. Goodbye.